My dear sisters and brothers, do not be surprised if my khutbah today will go over many topics, because as usual, this minbar is a portray of what is happening to us. And in the last few days, so many things touched our hearts. So I will try to put a string through these topics, knowing that Islam cannot be separated into units. It is always interconnected. So to start with, tell me of anyone among us who did not start to have his heart move fast and turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making dua on behalf of those children and older people and women and men who are living in the midst of a weather pattern that is unknown to the Middle East. Here we get a storm, we run into our homes, we turn on the heat to a favorable temperature, and we sit and we look out of the window and we enjoy the white snow. It is not the same there. It is totally different, and we saw how children there do not have boots. You know, your children wear boots to school. They had slippers in the midst of snow and mud and cold weather. And this is the test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, testing some with patience and testing others with oblivious behavior. Where are you going to spend your money? How are you going to deal with conditions that some have no control over, yet others may be able to help with? So we leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, not being a pattern that has been known before must catch our attention, because there are some prophecies that we read in the books that talk about the approach of the hour. And let me say, I am not here in a position to confirm or deny or say for sure or no. We read a hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we make an observation, we say Allahu A'lam. But in a hadith reported by Ahmed in his Musnad through the authority of Abu Huraira, لا تقوم الساعة حتى تصير بلاد العرب مروجا وأنهارا وحتى يسير الراكب من العراق إلى مكة لا يخاف إلا خطر الطريق وحتى يكثر الهرج. قيل وما الهرج يا رسول الله؟ قال القتل. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said more than 1400 years ago that the hour that will usher the day of judgment will not strike until the Arabian Peninsula will turn into pastures and rivers, and until he who is traveling between Iraq and Mecca will go without any fear, except that he may take a wrong turn in the journey, and until killing for no reason will spread all over the land. And in another hadith reported by Muslim through the authority of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, while the Sahaba were accompanying Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his way to Tabuk. Just before they arrived in Tabuk, Mu'adh ibn Jabal was next to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him and said to Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh, توشك إن طالت بك حياة أن ترى ما هاهنا وقد ملئ جنانا. He said, O Mu'adh, if your life is long enough, you will come to a point where this land in this area will be filled with gardens and it will be all green. Now, weather and climate specialists are confirming that we are now moving towards a weather where in the southern part of the hemisphere there will be more rain and there will be more of these similar weather patterns and things will be moving southward. Now, if that is the case, we expect to see these kind of things. However, I am not talking about the pastures only, but I would like to mention when I am seeing the children walking among the tents, that despite the heavy load of snow, were able to withstand the rain and the very difficult weather patterns. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith reported again by Ahmed and Ibn Hibban in his Sahih, and he said that as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا تقوم الساعة حتى تمطر السماء مطرا لا تكن له بيوت المدر وتكن له بيوت الشعر. He said, the sa'a will not strike that will usher the day of judgment until there will be heavy, heavy rain that regular houses made of mud and bricks will not be able to stand that kind of rain. But strange enough, the tents that are made from the skin of camels or similar material will be able to withstand that. Sadaqa Rasulullah. I'm mentioning all of this because these are signs on the way towards the hereafter. We are traveling and we are looking right and left and we are seeing these things happening to us, yet many Muslims are in a state of ghafla, heedlessness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the beginning of Surah Al-Anbiya told us very clearly, right at the beginning, why Surah Al-Anbiya? Because it talks about all the Anbiya that Allah sent to us to tell us, be careful, slow down, go right, go left, go straight. Yet, اِقْتَرَبَ لِلنَّاسِ حِسَابُهُمْ وَهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مُعْرِضُونَ. Our hisab, our day of judgment is becoming near and we are oblivious, we are in a state of heedlessness. And you will say, what do you mean, we are not seeing it? Well, at the time of the revelation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already said, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. At the time of revelation, Allah already said, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ. So we're not counting by days or weeks or months, but we've got to be careful how we see those signs happening to the people, and we have to be careful in approaching our Islam before we will find that because of our heedlessness, we ended up like the one that everybody went crazy about. I already forgot his name. You know, he's that star that young people, Muslims before non-Muslims, went crazy because he had a crash. Because he was driving his Porsche at a very high speed. So he had a crash and he died. He was in a ghafla. He thought he could challenge death. And the same thing is happening to us. We think that we can challenge anything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, before you will end up in the fire of hell, be careful. وَلَقَدْ ذَرَأْنَا لِجَهَنَّمَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنسِ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا وَلَهُمْ أَعْيُنٌ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ بِهَا وَلَهُمْ آذَانٌ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا أُولَئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُّ أُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْغَافِلُونَ أُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْغَافِلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be careful. Drive properly. See things as they happen. Don't drive foolishly. Because we have assigned to the hellfire many of the jinn and ins. Why? Why? Because they are not good drivers. They were taught how to drive by a heart, but they are driving foolishly. لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا. They know the rules, but they don't follow the rules of the road. And they have eyes, but their eyes are not on the road. There are many people who are texting and driving at the same time. Don't be surprised if you will crash, because these eyes are for the road, not for your iPhone. And وَلَهُمْ أَذَانٌ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا. Somebody may be driving beside you and you are driving in a crazy fashion. And may honk and honk and you're not listening. You're not listening. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is honking to us 5 times every day. Allah is saying 5 times every day, adjust your driving. So the result is, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ. Because have you seen an animal driving a car? Such people who do not look on the road or listen to the honking or follow the rules of the road, they are going to end up like that Hollywood star and many others ended up. So we have to be very careful. There are people actually who are good drivers, and they were good drivers even without going to a driving school. I did not go to a driving school, and many did not go to driving school, yet we drove, and we wrote a test, and we went into a driving test, and there are people who are driving properly. Not everybody goes to a driving school. Nelson Mandela died as a non-Muslim, yet he drove his car much better than any of those who went to driving school. Nelson Mandela followed the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without knowing. Or perhaps, as they say, because there were many Muslims with him in jail in South Africa. God knows what kind of interaction happened, but they interacted, and now Nelson Mandela came out of his jail and did not feel that he wanted to revenge from those who put him behind bars for 27 years. As if, without allowing myself to make that comparison, as if he said to those jailers who put him behind bars for 27 years, as if he said to them, اذهبوا فأنتم طلقاء. As if he told them what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the leaders of Mecca. After he could have done anything, he said to them, اذهبوا فأنتم طلقاء. Go, you are free. Because this is Islam. This is Islam, and yet today we are finding we are finding many carriers of the flag who are killing each other, who are assuming, oops, I almost started talking politics. Stop, period. New line. New line. I just want to end the first khutbah by saying this. By saying this. I read something that moved my heart so much. I said, subhanAllah, many times we read the Quran, but some sit with the Quran and they, you know, pick things that are beautiful flowers to make a bouquet. And one of those bouquets that I really admire is, depending on what you are seeking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used in the Quran the right description. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about four things that we seek. Our rizq, sustenance, and our salat, which saves us, and Jannah, which is our destination, and Allah, who is the ultimate that we are looking for. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, maybe it needs to be adjusted from the room. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Al-Quran Al-Kareem about our sustenance and our salat, Jannah, and Allah, the ultimate goal of all. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describe our seeking of our rizq? He said, Famshu, just walk towards your rizq. You don't need to move fast. You don't need, as we read in Surah Al-Mulk, هُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ ذَلُولًا فَمْشُوا فَمْشُوا, just walk. فَمْشُوا فِي مَنَاكِبِهَا وَكُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِهِ وَإِلَيْهِ النُّشُورِ. Just walk and you will get your sustenance. Because sometimes your sustenance will come to you. So just walk. Look at this, walk. Now salat, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا. It's a little bit faster than walking. فَاسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. And look at Jannah. وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ. Here you are, quick. Now what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about him? He said, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنِّي لَكُم مِّنْهُ نَذِيرٌ مُّبِينٌ. You know what's firru? Al-farar, it's the fastest you can run. The fastest. There's nothing faster than farar. So, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. So, فَمْشُوا وَسْعَوْا وَسَارِعُوا وَفِرُّوا. So go to the Quran, open the Quran, and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about what I'm going to mention in the second khutbah. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَيَا فَوْزَ الْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will accept our dua. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you can see, I'm moving from one topic to another to another to another, and now we are coming to this topic that I hope we really listen very carefully to. You know, what is mentioned in Seerah as Hadithat al-Ifq. Hadithat al-Ifq is a rumor that started against Aisha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some people, allowed themselves to enjoy passing rumors, because rumors for some people naturally People like to feel that they are the source of something. It doesn't matter whether it is true or false. They just like to propagate rumors. إِذْ تَلَقَّوْنَهُ بِأَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَتَقُولُونَ بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ مَا لَيْسَ لَكُمْ بِهِ عِلْمٌ وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ وَلَوْلَا إِذْ سَمِعْتُمُوهُ قُلْتُمْ مَا لَنَا أَنْ نَقُولَ هَذَا سُبْحَانَكَ هَذَا بُهْتَانٌ عَظِيمٌ يعظكم الله أن تعودوا لمثله أبدا إن كنتم مؤمنين ويبين الله لكم الآيات والله عليم حكيم صدق الله العظيم. The story Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that you receive the rumor and you spread it with your tongues and you think that it is just talk, but it is very serious with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You think it's just talking, but it is extremely serious with Allah. Have you said after hearing the rumor, we shouldn't propagate it because this is a kind of seriousness we cannot handle? Allah admonishes you. يَعِذُكُمُ اللَّهُ أَن تَعُودُوا لِمِثْلِهِ, that you would ever return to spreading rumors, provided in kuntum mu'mineen, if you have genuine faith. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah makes his ayat clear to you. And Allah is alimun hakeem. He is all-knowing, he is all-wise. I'm mentioning this because many things happen and are visible, and people love to put a caption to the things they see, observe, or hear about. They put spices on, and then they start to spread that. And I tell you, Allah does not like that. So that is why I wanted to mention the following from the minbar, so that Allah is my witness as I am starting with the Quran. Before I tell you what is next, those who really love to put a spin for what they are going to hear will desist and will say that this is not befitting for us to spread. I announced, or it was announced some time ago, that I have finally settled in the position of full-time imam at the Islamic Center. And I, Allah is my witness, did that with that intention. And I thought that I could establish a balance between my commitment to my family. I don't mean my blood family. I mean my London Muslim family. And at the same time, keep my commitment to the Muslims outside of London. I could not just tell them goodbye and stay in London after having years of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped me to do outside. I thought I could do that. But after a few months, 3 months exactly, I found that this is not balanced for me. And I could not establish that balance. And I decided that rather than struggling with this balance, that we should work together as the Islamic Center to seek an opportunity which is right in the midst of us, one of us, a leader among us, who is now just changing places, like Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah and Khalid ibn al-Walid did. Both of them great leaders, yet they changed positions. So he who is one of us, we approached him. And I say we, yes, we. Because I did not say to the leaders, to the board, go and suit yourself, I cannot do it. I said, let's do it together. And we approached our Sheikh and Imam Jamal Taleb.
And yes, we approached him. And he said, I am ready. So as a center, together, we asked him, and he is now, and I tell you with a great deal of satisfaction, he is available for that local leadership that he had chosen for more than 15 years in London. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we did not have to go and search, but he was available. And he said, whether it is at 151 Oxford or whether it is at 951 Pond Mills, it is still the same family, the same community, the same people, and I am ready to work inside my family. So the news without any spices.
Sheikh Jamal Taleb is now the Imam of the Islamic Center. And we, yes, I consider myself with all of us, are going to work, not be spectators, work under his leadership, and that will allow me to go outside and continue doing what I have been doing, and inshallah, the balance will be established. So I hope that this is it, and we do not go and start to say this and that, and none of that. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وخطايانا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا باطلا باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم علمنا من ديننا ما جهلنا وذكرنا منه ما نسينا وكن معنا ولا تكن علينا عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم ودعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة